Good morning, everyone. I'm going to call to order this meeting of the Health, Environment, and Community Engagement Committee. We're meeting at a different time today. I am Cam Gordon. I'm chair of the committee, and I'm joined today by council members Lisa Bender, Andrew Johnson, and Elizabeth Glidden. We're a quorum of the committee, and we can conduct the committee's business. There are just two items on our agenda today. The first is a consent item authorizing an amendment to a contract with Next Gen Healthcare Information Systems to allow electronic reporting of school-based clinic program immunization data to the Department of Health with no charge, with no change to contract dates or amounts. Would anybody like to pull that off for a discussion or more information? Seeing none, then I'm going to move that consent item. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Then our one discussion item is next, and that is the city's comments on Excel's resource plan. And Brendan Slaughterbeck will make a presentation on that and we can have some discussion. Good morning, Mr. Slaughterbeck.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. I know at least two of you have seen this presentation already, so I'm going to try to strike a balance between expediency and detail, also please feel free to interrupt me if you have questions during during the presentation. So Xcel Energy has submitted a 15-year resource plan. Just a bit of background before I get into the overview of the city's comments on the plan that we're proposing to submit to the Public Utilities Commission. In Minnesota, integrated resource planning is a 15-year planning tool that's used by electric utilities to identify how they will meet their customer needs in a reliable and low-cost manner. By Minnesota state law, it must be an integrated plan, meaning it has to use supply and demand side resources. So they must identify energy efficiency goals that they are going to pursue, as well as the demand side, meaning the supply side, meaning the power plants that they might propose to build. By statute, these types of plans need to be filed every 2 years, although in practice that tends to be drawn out longer because it oftentimes takes longer than that to get a plan approved. Again, the final decision makers in this process are the Minnesota Public Utilities Commission, and that's the entity to which comments are due and to which we'll be submitting our comments. The Xcel Energy has filed this 15-year resource plan. We know that the plan will have impacts on our climate goals as well as our clean energy partnership goals. When the council considered the energy pathways study in 2014, in addition to kind of setting the stage for the formation of the clean energy partnership, the pathway study also strongly recommended that the city stay engaged in the state's regulatory process. Because that's ultimately where the buck often stops with energy issues. And in August 21st, the council adopted some energy and climate policy positions to guide the staff's work at the Public Utilities Commission. One of the top priorities for the next 2 years in that in those positions was the integrated resource plan. So there are some major issues that we identified when we were reviewing Xcel's resource plan that we wanted to identify for you. Obviously, the energy resource mix that they're proposing for the next 15 years and the related greenhouse gas emissions impacts. The future of the units 1 and 2 at Sherburne County Generating Station, also known as Sherco. Their goals for energy efficiency. And again, these are at the service territory level for Xcel Energy. Rate impacts, potential public health impacts. I wanted to also draw your attention to the fact that there have been alternative plans submitted in this process. So the PUC, any entity can actually submit an alternative resource plan for Xcel Energy. And the PUC has received two plans from two different entities. One was the Minnesota Department of Commerce Division of Energy Resources. And then the second plan was from a coalition of nonprofits calling themselves the Clean Energy Organizations.
Can I just ask about that? Can the PUC amend these plans and come up with their own plan, or do they have to pick from one of the other?
My understanding is that they can pick and choose components of different plans, or they can come up with something separate. But the plans that are submitted by these two entities, they differ in a number of ways, but some significant differences they have on these major issues include their treatment of those Sherco generating units, the energy efficiency goals, and some of the modeled costs. The comments that you have before you today do reference some information from these alternative plans, because we thought that was useful for our analysis of Xcel's plan. Just some brief background on what a few of the things that are in Xcel's plan before I get to the summary of the comments in the document before you. By 2030, Xcel does propose to add a significant number of renewable resources to their energy mix. So you can see in this slide both the 2015, the current energy mix, and the 2030 proposed mix in their resource plan. So they do plan to add a significant amount of wind and solar to their system by 2030. The state of Minnesota has, by state law, a set of energy efficiency goals for electric utilities, which are 1.5% annually. Xcel is proposing in this resource plan to keep that 1.5% goal for the first half of the planning period, and then actually reduce the energy savings goal for the second half of the planning period to 1.3%. And that's based on their analysis of the cost of doing energy efficiency over time. There wasn't a great deal of information about rate impacts in the current plan. Xcel has said to many of the commenters that they're going to be presenting more information on rate impacts of the plan over time. But you can see in this slide shows the incremental impact. So on a year-to-year basis, per kilowatt hour, the rate impacts of their proposed plan. But this is averaged over all customers in their service territory, so you can't really understand the different impacts to the residential versus commercial versus industrial classes. So our hope is that they'll be providing some more information on that. But this does show you that a lot of those rate impacts are, they're saying, will happen in the later years of the plan, and the earlier years are very small impacts compared with their sort of base plan. By 2030, they are proposing, or they're showing in their model that greenhouse gas emissions would decline by over 40% from 2005 levels. And this is their emissions from their system as a whole. And that's the red line for their current plan that they proposed. The blue line is their old plan, their last resource plan. So they've proposed a significantly different plan, significantly better plan in terms of greenhouse gas emissions from their previous version. The pollutants, criteria pollutants, so the pollutants that might affect public health, they're also showing a significant reduction by 2020. A lot of the improvements that they've made in terms of criteria pollutants, you can see, happened between 2005 and the present date. There will still be some improvements, but a lot of their major improvements had already happened. So it's 80% by 2020, but from the present date, it's not a significant reduction in criteria pollutants. Now, just a brief summary of the key items that are in the comment document that's before you. We do stress in this document that we have entered this agreement with Xcel Energy, this Clean Energy Partnership Agreement. We want to pursue together with them state and our local goals for greenhouse gas emissions reduction and energy efficiency. We do explain at some length in the comments about some of the great energy savings potential we believe is available in the city. And we suggest finally that an energy efficiency goal below 1.5% is probably not appropriate. Some of the other organizations that have submitted comments on this look back at Xcel's performance in energy efficiency and see they consistently have overperformed their goals at a lower cost than what they estimated. So we're saying you shouldn't adopt anything below the state goal of 1.5%, and indeed something above that might be appropriate. We recognize that the resource plan that they've laid out here is good in terms of carbon emissions. It will actually significantly help us reach our climate action goals by 2025. However, a number of the other commenters showed scenarios, including different treatment of those Sherco units that would have an even greater and quicker impact on emissions reduction at a cost that's very, very similar to what Xcel has proposed. So while our comments, we don't have the technical capability to run the computer models that these other commenters do, we're saying the results of those models show that alternative scenarios that have even quicker carbon reductions are very cost effective compared to Xcel's plan. And so there may be, we're encouraging the PUC to look at those scenarios, and if those are just as good, you should adopt a quicker carbon reduction than Xcel's proposed plan. The current plan that they've submitted shows the Sherco units 1 and 2, the older units, continuing to operate throughout the 15-year planning period. They're basically proposing to sort of ramp those down over time. And other plans like the Clean Energy Organizations plan and the Department of Commerce plan have different shutdown dates. So the Commerce Department shows repowering one of the units in 2025. The Clean Energy Organizations show actually shutting down both of those units within the planning period. And our comments basically say, again, we don't have the technical capability to model these scenarios and come up with our own plan. But we believe that the time is ripe now for the commission to identify what the future of those two units will be in this current planning period. So don't wait another 2 years till the next resource plan to decide what we're going to do with these two units. It takes a long time to figure out how they're going to replace that capacity. So everybody who's a stakeholder to this process needs certainty about what's going to happen. And so we're suggesting that the commission take some action within this resource plan to identify what the future of those two old units are. And just for reference, those, you know, the Sherco station is the largest greenhouse gas emitter in the state. It's also the largest emitter of soot pollution in the state. So this is a major decision and a huge piece of this plan. We have some comments that lay out that Xcel may be underestimating the desire of their customers for resources like distributed solar and community solar gardens. If the community solar gardens in Xcel's queue right now are all approved, they would basically use 75% of the capacity for that resource that they've identified over the next 15 years. So we're suggesting that they really need to take a look again about something that's more reasonable in terms of customer demand for solar, because we think that's only going to grow more over time. We have comments discussing the desires of energy customers. So we think that not only are energy customers wanting to be more transactive with their electric utility, but they're also, again, demanding these resources in the immediate future. So a lot of the renewables that Xcel is proposing to bring on are shown in their plan as post 2020 or post 2025. And we're saying you really need to show the strong demand that customers have for these resources now. And then finally, the state of Minnesota and the city of Minneapolis both have deep carbon reduction goals, or 80% goals for reduction by 2050. We're just suggesting to the commission and Excel that they continue to work collaboratively with other stakeholders, including the city of Minneapolis, on planning for those deep carbon reductions, because there may be actions we need to discuss and take now that will help us meet those long-term goals, and we shouldn't delay that discussion. The comment deadline for this plan is October 2nd. That is the date that we're hoping to get these comments into the PUC. There is also a place for the public to comment to the Public Utilities Commission on their website. So we're encouraging anybody who's interested to also submit individual comments, because those do get reviewed by the Public Utilities Commission. That concludes my presentation, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
I have a few questions and maybe ideas, but is the Clean Energy Partnership mentioned at all in the resource plan?
Chair Gordon, it is mentioned by Excel in their resource plan that they submitted. It's kind of a recognition that this is an initiative that Excel is undertaking with the city of Minneapolis. I think we, in our comments, try to leverage that a little bit further and say, this is a new kind of initiative, and it shows that we can tap a lot of this energy savings potential, especially that we haven't been able to tap before working separately. And that's a reason we kind of put that under the box of why they should adopt a higher energy savings goal. Say, we've got all sorts of untapped potential that we can help you leverage.
I saw that and I appreciated that. And generally, I really appreciate the comments and the themes in all of them. I do have an issue maybe with the tone or the emphasis of some of them. So maybe we can come back to that in a minute. And maybe I see our role as potentially pushing them a little bit further. And maybe there's a chance for the council to help bump up the emphasis a little bit in the comments. But I'll let some other council members weigh in and ask questions too. Council Member Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thanks for the excellent presentation. I was curious, you may not be able to answer this offhand, but as we look at our greenhouse gas emissions goals and our reduction goals by 2030 and 2050, or is it 2025 and 2050?
Right, correct.
Do we know, for example, if this is the scenario we're working with Excel, how that impacts our ability to reach those goals, particularly by 2025, and what else we would have to do to keep on track for that?
Chair Gordon, Councilmember Bender, we did some forecasting back a couple of years ago when we did the climate action plan to look out how might the future look under sort of a business as usual scenario. And we think that if you applied the greenhouse gas reductions that Excel is proposing in their resource plan to kind of a business as usual case, so sort of a small amount of growth of electricity over the next 10 years, that the mix that they're proposing would help us meet, at least in the electricity sector, that 30% reduction goal. Now that assumes a lot of things, like the growth of electricity, for example, doesn't change its trajectory significantly. It also assumes that they implement the plan exactly as it's laid out for the commission. But we also know that the electric sector might need to outperform its goals just by itself to help us meet our overall goals, because those include the transportation sector and the waste sector and other sectors that are a little bit harder to move. I think electricity has shown a lot of progress over the recent history. So we don't want to say that, 30% in the electricity sector is like enough and the minimum. We want to build in as much wiggle room, I guess, as possible, and encourage them to do as much as they can to reduce even faster.
Thank you. I think that's a really important point, because I think, for example, in the transportation sector, reducing by 30% by 2025 would require us to make some pretty significant changes in how we're operating today. And so I would agree that if we're going to reach our goals, that I think it makes it even more important. And in addition, because the electricity sector obviously has a higher proportion of the total emissions as well. So anyway, Mr. Chair, I appreciate your comments about making sure that this is as strong as possible.
So I'm, I guess I'm a little curious about what you think the appropriateness is of the council adapting it. And I'd like to look at a couple phrases that were used in the comments, and maybe talk about that, or just to kind of highlight where I think we maybe could do a little bit more. So the, one of the things is we talk about the energy savings goal of 1.5%. And it's really, I think it's great that we're saying you shouldn't lower that down to 1.3. But I'm wondering why we can't say that it actually should probably be higher for the entire plan. I know that we, so we talk about it a little bit like it could be the floor. And we think the program that is at least 1.5% annually for the entire planning period. And I think we could suggest it could even be increased. So it at least does that, but that was what I was looking at and saying, well, instead of going down after we've done a 1.5 efficiency, maybe we should consider going up, you know, over that. And saying it at least does do that, but we could challenge them to think about that we actually believe it should be increased over time. At least I think the council and the people in Minneapolis would generally say, of course, we have to increase efficiency if we're gonna really meet our goals, and we have to constantly be doing that over time. So that's one of my comments on your comments. Do you think we could adapt, we could modify slightly to do that?
Mr. Chair, I just wanna draw your attention. I think, well, at the bottom of page 2, we do say, we do sort of explore this idea that at the bottom of page 2, I guess at the top of page 3 as well.
That's right with the section I was looking at.
Yeah, we do, basically what we say now is that because of all this potential, the commission may be justified in adopting an energy savings goal above 1.5%. And is, that's the section you're referring to, correct? Yep. Some reference on that, I think I need to go back and check my notes. I think the clean energy organizations have proposed a 1.7% savings goal. The reason that we did not put that number specifically in these comments, I think we didn't feel that we, you know, we didn't do the modeling like these other organizations did. So picking a number, whether it's 1.6 or 1.7, I guess we weren't comfortable picking out exactly what that number was, but there is some very strong arguments, I think, from the other commenters that Excel would certainly be able, perhaps able to meet a higher goal than 1.5%. They've been above 1.5% in the past, actually. So obviously we could, you know, we would entertain any comments the council wants to put in here. I can't say for sure what exactly, I can't make a good recommendation to you about what exactly that number should be. Should it be 1.6 or 1.7?
So my idea wasn't to put in a number, but that third line of that last paragraph that begins with programs. So the sentence, it's a long sentence, but it says, we ask the commission adopt an energy savings goal for Excel's demand side management programs that is at least 1.5% annually and potentially increased over time for the entire planning period. So that's the idea that we could just throw that in there, and that would support the, I suppose, other plans. I hadn't read the other plan that said 1.7, but it would at least put us on record as thinking it should, agreeing with it, trying to increase it is worth it. And I could potentially send you some of these ideas too, and we could look at it for later. So I'm not sure if I even want to amend these here, but let me put that one in a placeholder and then go on to number 2, the second group of comments, which is on page 3. And there's a couple times in that section where we talk about levels at or below those in the preferred plan. And my question was, couldn't we just, in some of those instances, say that we want future carbon intensity levels below those in the preferred plan? Somehow, because at or below just sounded like we're not pushing far enough. But is so can you tell me if I'm way off base in a nice way?
No, I don't think that would be off base. I think the reason to use the language at was simply to recognize that the plan, you know, is a significant improvement from previous plans, and that if Excel was able to achieve what they've laid out in the plan, that it would technically bring the electricity sector into compliance with our goals. But I think using the cutting out the at and just using the below would be fine as well.
It would make it a little bit stronger. And there's a couple of places where we do that. I also, and I think we've talked about this before. So my third issue is I'd like to come out more strongly about the coal burning plants in the Sherco. And there's I don't know if you have the document in front of you, but there's one paragraph in that section where we mention it, and we say the city is also encouraged by the results from the scenarios. I wonder if we could go on record as somehow being more than encouraged by the scenarios, but we favor. I mean, I don't know how to change that wording. And there's a couple of places where we mention the Sherco plant. So there's that sentence. And then in section 3 at the top of page 4, we talk about how we want them to come up with a definite decision about the last sentence, I guess, repowering or retirement. And I think I'd like to just ask them to come up with a decision about when to identify a date for retirement. So, but that's I don't know if I represent the whole council on that, so people could weigh in. But, you know, these coal burning plants are a big problem, and they're not helping with climate change. And it's really positive that Excel is saying we're going to phase out the coal, and they're hearing that. And so my sense is if we could make the comments saying we support that and we want you to go a little further, it could be effective. I understand that we're not experts and you're not experts, but the city council pushes for things a lot of times without the expertise to know what we're doing necessarily, but we try to be as smart about it as we could. So do you think we could move that a little bit further?
Mr. Chair, I guess my only comment would be on the phrase repowering or retirement. I guess that piece, again, the council, you know, can modify these comments, but I think it's really uncertain at this time what the future resource will be that closes that gap. If we are to shut those two units down, even the Clean Energy Organization's plan, they show closing those two units, but then separately in a different geographic location, adding a significant amount of natural gas fired generated capacity elsewhere on Excel system. So their plan even is showing, you know, we need something, and probably fossil related to fill part of that gap at least. So I guess that I just wanted to make you aware that just saying retirement sort of might limit the options for what you could do, because they could also actually put natural gas into that facility as an alternative. So that's why we say repowering or retirement.
I appreciate options. That. I suppose we could explicitly say with natural gas, but maybe we could just leave it alone. Then I've got, I think, just a couple more questions. There's the last paragraph of section 4 there. This is the new section where we're talking about the demand for solar energy. And I just wanted something a little more strident and carefully consider the impacts of more significant growth. I think they'll probably get the idea of what we're saying that, but I think that the city is probably more enthusiastically supporting and wants to push Excel to allowing all the solar potential that we have, and there's this demand. And so I don't actually have a different way to say carefully considered, but we council a lot of times looked at these words and tries to think about it. I think we want this resource plan, I think, should really be pushing hard to get more solar and more wind. And there's definitely potential for significant growth in the solar end. So let's maybe we can put our heads together and think about how we could encourage that, because I think the trends and the customer demand are really great for this. But it's a little bit piddly, you know, to carefully consider or strongly, we would strongly encourage them to explore. I mean, I don't know how we'd say that and make it a little bit bigger emphasis. You have any feedback on that idea?
No, I guess, Mr. Chair, the only feedback, and this is sort of a communication I bring, I guess, from Excel's side, is that they have kind of a large tranche of solar, so to speak, that they've said between now and 2030, we expect this much solar to be on our system. And they've kind of said this much is utility scale and this much is distributed or either rooftop or in community gardens. So their response might be, well, we'll just move a little bit more into that customer driven side. But we still think that might actually change the resource plan, and that if they think customers are driving more of this uptake, we want to show through this resource plan that the market is there for those things. So that's my only feedback. But I think modifying this language could be, we could work on that.
Does the clean energy groups, do they call for more large solar on the community side, or they don't care where it's coming from?
I actually have a slide on that, Mr. Chair. So the column on the left side of the screen under clean energy plan, the clean energy plan is what those organizations call their plan. They're actually not calling for any more solar than Excel. And again, it's all just in this one lump of solar. They do say large solar here. I think they're consistent with Excel on, for the most part, the amount of resources that are brought onto the system. I don't think one of their major points was distinguishing between those two things.
Then my last question, I think, if you could go back to the graph we saw about greenhouse gas emissions and the decline. Did we, one back, or maybe two back. So it's the trend line, the red trend line and the blue trend line. There it is. Did we try to map, or do they map this trend line out into the future to see when we get to the 80% reduction that we wanted? I think by 2050, is that right? And do you think that this will get us there?
Mr. Chair, so this is their, I don't know if this is part of your question. This is their line from their plan on their whole service territory. So Minnesota, Wisconsin, other parts of other states as well. They did not, as far as I'm aware, they did not map this out to 2050. They have comments in their plan about what the major issues are that it would take to get to 80% reduction by 2050, but they don't map out a resource mix all the way out to 2050 like they did for this plan out to 2030. Some of their major considerations to get there are obviously the future of Sherco, the future of their nuclear generating units, the two of them in the state, you know, how much energy efficiency we can get over time. But we don't have a graph or any details from them on what's going to happen in 2050.
Okay. Well, it looks more hopeful than their old plan, though.
Correct.
That's nice to see. All right. I think those are my comments right now, and I don't know that I have any. I'm comfortable moving it forward, but maybe we can see if there's some minor modifications we can make before the council meeting that I could maybe move on. Substitute that way, unless there's other comments or discussion. I don't see anybody's lights up. All right. So on the motion to approve this action, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. That carries, and that concludes our business for today. Thank you very much. This meeting is adjourned.